Hello everyone, this is MJ with MinIO and welcome back to the MinIO on Kubernetes and MinIO Operator course. So in the last section of video, we talked about how to deploy the MinIO operator using the MinIO command line that uses the kubectl command line, as well as a crew plugin for installing the MinIO operator. You can also do the same to deploy tenants, and we're going to talk about that in this video. But first, let's talk about why we need tenants. So by default, if you deploy MinIO on natively on Linux or in Docker, or even using the YAML on Kubernetes, you're going to get a single tenant deployment of MinIO. And for many organizations, that might be fine. You might be only maintaining one static structure for your object storage using MinIO, and that might work okay. But for certain organizations, you're going to want to be able to provision individual deployments of MinIO, either for external customers or for internal groups in your organization. And they will have their own configurations for access credentials, storage, and other settings like that. So that's why we need tenants. So the tenant operator is actually going to be the foundation of this. And then you deploy different tenants on top of that. And each of those tenants can have their own independent deployments of MinIO that have their own configurations. And they can be administered and run separately from one another, even upgraded. So that's why we need tenants, and that's what we're going to be talking about in this video. So here we are at the section where we're going to be deploying a MinIO tenant using the kubectl command line. So the kubectl MinIO tenant create command supports creating a MinIO tenant in your Kubernetes cluster. This, of course, assumes that you've already deployed the MinIO operator. This command requires that the cluster has a functional operator installed, as I just said. And to deploy a tenant from the command line, you have to complete the following steps. So one, determine values for the required settings. Two, determine values for the optional settings. Three, run the command with the required and optional settings included. Record the access credentials, and we'll talk about that both in the slides and in the lab. And lastly, access the tenant MinIO console. So the kubectl MinIO tenant create command requires several configuration settings, requires them. So let's jump over to the documentation real quick, and I want to talk about the required settings. So here we are in the MinIO official documentation, and you can see that the very first section here is determining values for required settings. So the command requires values for each of the following items in this table. We're going to have to define a tenant name. We're going to have to define some capacity for how much storage the tenant is going to get. And please note this notation on how you're going to define that. So if it's 16 terabytes, it's going to be 16 capital T I. If it's going to be gigabytes, it's going to be capital G I. And that's just the indication of the size here in SI values. The number of servers to run. So if it's a very small deployment, maybe you'll only want to run one, or maybe if it's for testing purposes. But to be highly available across your Kubernetes cluster and to serve more clients who are trying to hit this, you might want to increase that server number maybe up to three or more. Additionally, how many volumes are going to be attached to these servers? So this gets into the total amount of storage that you're going to have, and also goes into a bit of the erasure coding, how MinIO distributes the objects that you're uploading across that storage so you can have resiliency. So if some of that storage goes down, the erasure coding picks up and you're still going to be able to access all of your content that you pushed up there. You're going to have to define a namespace. So in Kubernetes, everything is namespace to keep things separate. So you will not want to deploy tenants in the same namespace. That will cause problems. So you'll have a custom namespace specifically for this particular tenant. And then you also have to define the storage class that you built out on top of that. So in our case, we'll be using the DirectPV storage class, but your cluster may have something different. Next, we need to determine the values for the optional settings. So these aren't required, but they are optional, and you may want to use some of these to be able to configure your system. So let's jump into the docs for the optional settings. So the optional settings, you can define three different values currently. So you can define an image to use. So if you wanted to use a specific version of MinIO with this, you could define the MinIO image, and you could go on Quay or Docker Hub to find that exact image name. If you're pulling from a private registry, you can define an image pull secret. So basically how it's going to access that. And that secret would have to be loaded into Kubernetes, and you'd simply reference that secret when pulling down this image. And the last thing is a KES configuration. KES is a key encryption service maintained by MinIO. And so if you're keeping your secrets outside of your cluster and you want to be able to pull in a secret from outside of that, or if you want to do encryption using some sort of keys that you're storing against somewhere else, you can use a KES server deployed on top of MinIO and then define the KES configuration here in order to be able to pull those external secrets in. But again, these are optional and you do not have to do that if you do not want to. Also, we will not be covering these optional settings for the sake of this lab coming up. So once you have all of these things defined, your command will look something like this. So it'll be kubectl minio tenant create. In this case, we're creating a tenant called minio1. We're giving it a capacity of 16 terabytes or tebibytes, I think. I'm actually not sure how to say that one, but basically terabytes. Four servers, 16 volumes. The namespace is minio tenant space. We're defining a specific image release in this case. So it's going to be released from 4/20/2023. We're saying the KES configuration is the MinIO KES secret. And the storage class we're going to be putting this on is warm. Now, this is just an example. This is not the actual configuration we're going to run in the lab, but this is just so you could see how your command might end up looking. When generating the tenant, the MinIO operator displays the access credentials to use for the tenant. In addition to the access credentials, the output shows the service name and service ports to use for accessing the tenant. Very, very important. This is the only time the credentials will display. Copy the credentials to a secure location. MinIO does not show these credentials again. So if you lose these, you're going to have to go into the MinIO operator console and regenerate new credentials to be able to access this environment. So once you've gone ahead and deployed this, you can run kubectl get service and then the namespace for MinIO tenant one. And it's going to show you a number of different services that were created that you can then use to access your tenant. Depending on your cluster configuration, not all of these things will be deployed. Also depends on certain command line switches that you ran when you actually deployed your tenant. So you might not see all of these, but depending on your configuration, you will see some of these and you may be able to access it using one of these load balancer IPs or one of the other IPs listed here. Again, this is just an example. Yours will vary. The MinIO service corresponds to the MinIO tenant service. So that's, think of that as the server that's running for the tenant. The star-console, whatever the name of the deployment is, dash console, corresponds to the MinIO console for that tenant. So that's where you would actually log in and have the web UI to manage that tenant. And then the remaining services support tenant operations are really not intended for us to have to do anything with. They're just there to support what's deployed and provide some inner workings for MinIO to be able to communicate and do its uploads and downloads and storage. So in order to get this working, you're going to need to have this exposed externally, or rather, if you want external services to access this, you're going to need to expose this externally. So that's where something like a load balancer or DNS name external service would come in and access the external IP. This value is only populated for Kubernetes clusters configured for ingress or similar network access services. So in our lab that we're going to do, we're actually going to configure an ingress to be able to get to our tenant. Kubernetes provides multiple options for configuring the access to the external services. And like I said, that includes ingress, that includes load balancing, that includes port forwarding. Port forwarding, as you've seen in previous labs, is a temporary thing. So you probably don't want to use that. You'll probably want to configure a load balancer or an ingress. And you will want to refer to the Kubernetes documentation on publishing services and service types or ingresses for more complete information. We're not going to go too deep into that in this course. But you will need some Kubernetes knowledge to be able to do that. So that's all the slides I have for deploying a tenant using the kubectl MinIO command line. In the next section, we're going to jump into a lab, and I'm actually going to show you how to do this. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.